Let me extend a very warm welcome to each of you right here at ET Edge Employee Excellence 2023, our second edition, which really does talk about empowering, about engaging, about excelling. And it is not just a theme. These are not just words. These are beliefs. We truly feel that today, when we talk about diversity, when we talk about inclusion, they aren't just buzzwords. They aren't just words that we'd like to have in our portfolio. But these are our beliefs. To recognize some of the leading companies who have made a mark in employee excellence for the financial year 2022-23, our knowledge and research partner, Grandview Research, laid down certain parameters along with the weightage across segments to have a robust review of assessors. And as we kickstart and talk about a very special segment, harnessing the power of cooperatives, building inclusive and resilient communities, it is such a pleasure to have amongst us Satoshi Sasaki-san, Director, International Labour Organization, joining us to really take this program to a new level.
It's my pleasure to speak before you today. I stand here representing the International Labour Organization, which is the United Nations first specialized and only tripartite agency that equally support employers, workers, and government to help advance decent work for all women and men, which is the heart of the social justice. The theme of today's world event is Empower, Engage, and Excel. An organization is built by its people and the values it's propounded to help build a culture that attracts top talent. The pandemic marks a turning point in what its culture represents and how it should be shaped for the future. Over the past few years, the labor market has undergone tremendous change through mega drivers such as technology, demography, globalization, and climate change. These drivers have created entirely new jobs and wiped out others, created the need for new skills while making certain skills entirely redundant, empowering one section of workers while disenfranchising another. In this context, we must build a future of work that is equitable and provide opportunities for enterprises and their workforce to thrive. The profile of work is changing. The labor market is now characterized by young people who are increasingly dynamic and better trained by ways of education and skills they possess. Three types of skills are increasingly important in the labor market: complex problem-solving skills, social behavioral skills like teamwork, and skills combination that are predictive or for the adaptability, such as for the reasoning and self-efficacy. Building these skills requires strong human capital foundations and lifelong learning. We need to create a learning models that would promote cooperation over competition and culture of shared growth. We cannot only have organizational goals for an employee to achieve. There need to be systems that are mutually beneficial to the organization and the employee when achieving their respective goals. With Generation Z slated to make up nearly one-third of the global workforce by 2025, and increasingly, they value work and workplaces which align with their personal motivations. 51% of the Generation Z employees are more likely to prioritize health and well-being over work. Diversity and inclusion are another factor to incorporate into the organization's culture and mission, as it yields benefits for enterprises, societies, and the economy at large. The creation of jobs and wealth needs to also account for working conditions and career progression of the workforce, which will compel them to perform better in their duties. So with this, I look forward to the fruitful discussion today and how we can help business and workers empower, engage, and excel. Thank you very much.
Our next panel will be discussing curating an exquisite medley of vantage points, celebrating diversity, and cultivating inclusion.
Harjit ji, let's begin with you. If you would like to make a movie as a director, what will be the key elements that you think you will put in that movie with regards to DEI in line with a company?
You have seen this movie, Tu Jhooti Main Makkar. Thing is, the lady doesn't want to marry in a joint family. So that means you don't like culture of a particular place. And you don't want to get into that place. So if you have to bring yourself to that place, you are not going to accept it, and the workplace is also not going to accept it, because your objectives are totally different. So when you are selecting people, it is not only the ecosystem, it is also that when you are selecting people, you have to figure out why they are joining your organization. You have to understand the goals, motivations of the individuals whom you are bringing in, whether they match with your culture and your value set.
I want to jump to Septo. How do you propose to startups for them to embrace DEI? Because as you know, startups are always back to back, doing multiple roles unless they grow.
I think a lot of organizations in the startup world are experimenting a lot. So a lot of inhibitions actually just fall away because you need somebody to do the job. It doesn't really matter, which cadre or which block that person belongs to in the overall society, but what matters is the value that you bring on the table. If any, I think there is such a great interlearning that's happening because a lot of, I wouldn't say traditional, but a lot of setup orgs which are not startups are learning from us. And at the same time, as we move through the journey of becoming a lot more bigger, scaling up, accelerating, we are learning the nuances of diversity from organizations which have been around for a longer time.
How do you ensure that diversity from the bottom up and from the top down as well, which tends to be lagging at times? How do you manage that balance?
In life insurance, when I joined the industry, it was a very male-dominated organization. However, there were reasons for this. The reasons were that a lot of women were not okay to work for long hours, and we also understand that the biological clock of a woman also works very closely with the career clock, right? And it becomes extremely difficult because organizations were not very inclusive in accepting the biological clock of a woman, which now has changed. So are we having more maternity benefits? Are we having more acceptance for women when they come back from the organizations? To a fact that when now I look at it, I have more women at senior positions come up the ladder. A marriage works when both people bring in their own set of values to each other, right? There are a few things that a male brings in, and there are a few things that a woman brings in. An organization is an analogy to it. And the organization is okay to bring in that entire ecosystem. I think it's going to work fine.
How do you measure the output? How do you measure the success? How do you think enterprises can really measure DEI for real?
We are Louis Vuitton Moët Hennessy, right? Our oldest brand is 400 years old. You do not get to complete 4 centuries unless you do something right. We say, if you bring empathy and if you can create inclusion within your organization, you will achieve better results. You will have better growth. This comes from our data, which is 400 years old from one brand. And if we put all of our 84 brands together, it's thousands of years of knowledge that we look into to say DE&I actually works.
At Raymond, our leadership competency framework is used for hiring the best talent, developing employees, promoting and enabling role movements, encourages excellence in thought, action, and relationships. The performance management system, built on the ethos of creating a culture of outperformance, measures excellence and enables us to provide the right stimulus to develop excellence as a way of life. We have a distinguished journey for our talent under the aegis of Raymond University which focus on high performance culture and growth mindset. We define excellence a result of high intention, exemplary effort, skillfully and speedily executing the same. At Raymond, our leadership competency framework is used for hiring the best talent, developing the employees, promoting and enabling role moments.
Our focus is to develop our employees so that they can meet the future challenges. For that, we take care of their, based on their potential, we provide them the trainings for their development. We align our training programs for the development and expose them to all various areas of NTPC operations. NTPC has a presence all over India, so we are keeping our workforce ready for the future challenges.
For now, we are all set to begin our very interesting conversation where we will be talking about how weaving a web of digital expertise is today very, very important. Unraveling the quirks and the charms of the digital world, something that we really can't stay away from.
Why do we feel digital dexterity is important? And to put a little meat in the game, what success have you guys seen by bringing a digital ecosystem or a digital culture or digital thinking, mindset, whatever you want to call it, inside your respective organization? So Atma, if I can start with you, and Amrita, I'll pass it on to you after that.
See, first and foremost, what is happening these days, the organization is scaling up. You go from one country to one region to the entire global. So scaling up is impossible if you don't go digital. That is the first thing. Second thing, we see a lot and lot of reports, what Bhavya will talk more about around the ESG covering from the board and the governance system, that brings transparency and the data integrity. So that will also never happen if you don't have digital systems in place. Third thing, I would take a little tweak here. It's not about having a digital dexterity or digital mindset in place. I come from the world of tech where for me, adoption is not a challenge, but say moving from version 3 to version 4 is a challenge. You know, how do we make sure that people are using the right version in the right manner? So I think we are a little ahead in the curve, if I may say. So these are the three things which are very, very important in terms of if you want to survive or rather thrive as an organization across the globe.
Namrata, over to you.
From an organizational experience as an HR person, I think that your whole ecosystem has to support digital. I think you have to become a digital mindset is much bigger than, it's about uniformity, it's also about inclusivity, and how do you define it? So we sat down, and I was talking to a customer of ours, and I do these customer experience journeys with design experience. So I was saying, customer, does it matter to you if our organization is digital or not? He says, it doesn't matter to me at all whether you're digital or not, but because you're digital, it shows me how progressive you are, right? Very, very so nice. In a way, digital organizations are perceived to be progressive organizations.
What would you say are the biggest do's and don'ts? And if at all there's any learning that you had during this journey, any one or two that you can pass on?
Don't go after a tool.
Yeah.
So tools look really sexy. And it's great to pull this tool, some nice vendor, great salesman, or from somebody from KPMG comes and tells you, this tool is great. But don't go over a tool. So tool is not the end of it. See what works for you. It doesn't mean it worked in, let's say, my previous organization. It'll work here.
In summary, don't run behind the tools. Make tools run for you. You know, you keep telling us that digital culture is important, digital ecosystem is important, skill sets is important. Fine, let others do it, let them invest, we'll just buy it out. Why do we build it? Because if I build it, it's in demand, they will get poached. So why do I invest into it, right?
See, what I have seen in the current role in the previous organization also, it has to be the right trade-off.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't buy out each. So in my previous organization, what has been done that all the countries they had, I think there was around 6 R&R platforms over and all. So integration becomes a super challenge. Having said that, your core is something, when I say core, not the SCM core suite, core of the business, the tool if you can build this in-house, nothing beats that. You know, there's Salesforce and the tools are there. So the trade-off is very important. What makes sense for the business in terms of the customer centricity? Budgets are very important. That is the second point. And third, simplification. What works best for me, whether I deploy my in-house resource or I go and buy out and integrate it into my existing system? So I think that is the answer.
So at HDFC Ergo, we know that dynamism is a core value of the organization, and nothing reflects it better than continuously assessing against aligned goals. In that, our performance management philosophy, GAIN, takes prominence. GAIN stands for Gauge, Align, Inspire, and Nurture, and it's an all-around-the-year performance management philosophy that we carry forward. Everything leads to constructive discussions, continuous improvement, training, and learning that makes high performers become the best versions of themselves, and also assess people at the bottom of the rating scale. It's a performance philosophy for all individuals, with no one left behind.
This is the ice-breaking session, a session where I'd like for all of you to open your minds, remove the bias from your mind, not just say, oh, this is probably for an hour, but actually open your minds, embrace the difference, or embrace everything that you feel you'd like to have here, from people power to business brilliance.
A question for you, maybe first, Harish, from my side is, you know, you enjoying working at the bank in the corporate life? Do you think more people should join in?
The biggest work is social work, which people do relentlessly, and I don't think corporates do as well, because we at least have some goal to achieve in the end.
Yeah.
There are some people I know who work in the social sector for years and years together. They get the same kind of salary, and their entire purpose is, and some of them are as good as Axis Bank or KPMG. They're very well organized, very well this thing. They can give us a lesson or two. Sometimes there is also arrogance that comes with money, and corporate India has a lot of arrogance. Corporates have a lot of arrogance. They think they know everything. And sometimes the most important of things are from the most basic of people, you'll notice. The most complex engineering comes from the most basic of things. I think corporate arrogance should give way to social intelligence that people have.
You operate out of, you know, remote area of Gujarat, or, you know, and also you have a lot of these. So I'm just trying to understand, how does this inclusion should happen? Or in your views, with all your effort, how some of those MSME, the small companies, the manufacturing sectors or those retail sectors, what's your view? How they are looking up to it?
We are dealing with people, especially in the remote parts, in the rural areas. Again, the education is not an issue. But it's again about the mindset of the people. We need to get the people to hear our stories, you know. And when people hear our stories, people hear our examples, what we have lived through and what we have gone through in our lives, I think that impacts the people a lot, and they kind of try to understand that, yeah, I mean, this person has gone through hell, you know, whether you're a prince or you're a banker, it doesn't make a difference, you know, we are all having the same problems, you know, in the life. I just love my haters. Each time somebody sends me a hate remark, hate message, you know what I do? I send them a big heart. And then the more they hate me, I send them two hearts, you know, I say, I love you. And, you know, then that person tries to find out, oh my God, why does this person loving me so much when I'm hating that person? I said, well, I love you. Whatever you do for me, I still love you.
And as we take this moment forward, may I request all of you to please put your hands together and extend a very warm welcome to Satoshi Sasaki-san, a director, International Labour Organization, on stage yet again to unveil the much-awaited ET Edge Employee Excellence 2023 Coffee Table Book. ETH Employee Excellence 2023, recognizing them for the excellence that they brought to the table. Let's hear it up for Altimetric India Private Limited. Up next
is Apparel Group India Private Limited. Up next is Bharat Electronics Limited. Many, many best wishes. Please put your hands together for Biocon. Let's hear it up for Cipla. Thank you so very much for joining us. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for Cummins India. Up next is Edelweiss Tokyo Life Insurance. Up next is Embassy Property Developments Private Limited. Up next is Galderma India Private Limited. Let's hear a round of applause for HDFC Ergo General Insurance. Up next is Hinduja Housing Finance. Up next is Max Life Insurance. Up next is Moët Hennessy India Private Limited. Please do put your hands together for NTPC Limited. Let's hear it up for Ramco Systems. It's time we hear a cheer for Raymond Lifestyle Business. Our best wishes. Taking the walk of fame, up next is SAP. Up next is Tech Mahindra. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for Usha International. May I request all of you to please put your hands together for Utkarsh Small Finance Bank. Right here at ET Edge Employee Excellence 2023, it's time that we felicitate Xanadu Realty Limited. A round of applause to them, please. It's time to inspire momentum. ET Edge Employee Excellence 2023. Let's hear a round of applause and some cheers for Yota Data Services. Our best wishes and more to every brand that made it up here. Let me take a moment and thank you, sir. It's been so very kind of you that you could join us. And let me also take this moment by thanking all of you for joining us, making our second edition such a success. Cheers to an amazing evening of celebration. Thank you.